Guys, hello and welcome to Skycurser Daily number 37. Today on the docket, we're going to pick up where we left off with our last stream. And that has partially to do with the weapon system, and it also has partially to do with the enemies on level 2. So, additionally, I was able to get through adding the weapons, and where I left off with the Vulcan cannon weapon with our script last time was related to making sure that a data structure map was not created for every single bullet that was on screen for every single step of that bullet. So we were just killing our processing power by doing that. Now we're only creating a data structure map if there's actually a collision with a specific object. So before I hop into anything else, I'd kind of like to show that off. I had been talking about it, and we had been working on it for a minute on two or three, maybe even four of our streams, trying to work through and work through getting all of the bullets into the script correctly, mainly because we're going to pass other weapons through the same script, and we wanted to be able to control everything through one point of contact and also reduce duplicate code where possible. So I think we've done a pretty good job of that right now with the Vulcan cannon. And so let's just take a look at our structure of that and how that's set up. So first of all, let's go in game. The Vulcan cannon is basically the same thing as the minigun. We have three weapons, as you're familiar with by now. There's the shotgun, the Vulcan cannon, and the katana blade. So let's just hop in game. And again, we're just focusing right now on the katana blade. And I will pull up the compile window so we can watch it compiling here. First one always takes the longest. While that's compiling, I'll start talking through how all this is putting itself together. And so here's the mini blast bullet. This is one of the weapons that is fired by Skycurser. So we go into the step event. We immediately are passed over to the script weapon step event. And in the script weapon step event, looks like we're about to load here in a second, so we'll probably hop out of here. We'll pick this back up here in just a second when we're finished with this. So I'm just trying to demonstrate that it's working and is flowing smoothly at the moment. So script weapon step is right here. This is what this particular object gets passed to in the step event. Looks like we're going in game.
Skycurser. Mission 1. Death at dusk. Go!
So this is the Vulcan cannon. Look, it's it's working just fine. There's no slowdown. We've got the score indicator functioning pretty well at this point. Right now, again, we've only affected. We haven't affected the shotgun bullets, and we have not affected the katana blade. So, again, I'm just demoing the Vulcan cannon bullets. So this is the weapon that I'm using right now, and it's working just fine. It's really smooth. Think we're in a good spot there. All right, so looking at this script, here's the object. It's going through script weapon step. It doesn't have a parent or a child at the moment, may in the future, but for now. And it then calls the this is the enemy list. EL equals enemy list. And so we're creating a list. And I did say that we're removing the data structure map. So each one of these is not getting a data structure map created, but we're building this a little bit smarter than we had it previously. We're basically building up a list and then looping through it like we would loop through an array. And so the list is built with each one of these. We're basically looking at these are the enemies in these are the potential enemies in level one. These are the potential enemies in level two. And if we're in level one, we add these enemies to the list. When we get down here, we do var I equals zero. I is less than DS list size. So if you're familiar with data structures in GameMaker, they're basically a way to create arrays, if you're familiar with other programming languages, or you know, a list of items that you can loop through and apply certain thing, you know, apply certain programming aspects to. So I equals zero, I is less than the DS list size, and we give it the index of the list, and then I plus plus, so we're just incrementing through the list here, and then we pass everything through script weapon collision check. We're passing argument zero, which is the weapon. Remember how we passed to script weapon step from the object, we passed script weapon step, and then we passed self. So argument zero is self right here, similar to this. So when we pass argument zero in, we're passing the weapon object, and then we're also referencing, as we're looping through this list here, we're referencing the enemy list at, in this case, the I, which is incrementing every time through the loop. So when it hits that, it's going to hit script weapon collision check. So we're, if you were watching me build this out previously, I was creating a data structure map every single time I was looping through here. And that was causing some slowdown in the gameplay. It's a lot of processing power. The slowdown is really dependent on how good or fast the computer is. My computer is kind of an old computer, so it was slowing my machine down a little bit. And so we're just trying to optimize where possible, right? So we check for a hit or a collision. Argument zero, again, is the weapon object, and argument one is the object with which the weapon is colliding. So it would be object enemy one or two or three or boss or enemy one, you know, enemy four. So if there is a collision, then we go into the collision generate script, right? We're passing in, again, we're passing in the weapon, the hit, this piece right here, and then the X and Y position of argument zero. And we're doing that intentionally so that we can just hand that off later on to the collision, the piece that actually does a collision impact, so we can show the collision impact later on. So script collision gen is next. Inside script collision gen, I basically have to add a couple more arguments here. So let me add these while we're talking. Argument 2 equals object weapon X. Argument 3 equals object weapon Y. Could we have done this a little differently? Sure, we could have. We could have, you know, just passed in argument 0.x and y right here. But since we're passing it from the other script, we'll just keep passing it here. I think the important thing, I think one of the main reasons why I wanted to pass x and y right here was because this is the instant for sure when we have the X and Y position. And I feel like I've noticed basically as the script is running, steps can continue occurring while the scripts are running. So my goal was to make sure that I passed that instant of the X and Y position to this script. And that's really why I passed it in right here, and passing it to the DS weapon map generate. So let's go look at that real quick. This is where we generate our weapon map based on the enemy that is coming through. So this is helpful right here because this allows us to put all of our enemies in one place and control all of the intricate details of the enemies that we want to control in script. And I'm just going to pause for 1 second here, guys. Give me 1 minute, please. All right, sorry about that, guys. I'm back and picking up where we left off. So we just have a switch case statement here that allows us to go through any of the enemies and keep everything in one place. I've got basically everything spelled out here, what the data structure values are going to be. And right here, I'll just put object weapon X. These are two things that I added yesterday, object weapon Y. And I don't necessarily want to set these every single time. That's the beauty about a data structure map over a data structure list, where a map allows you to set keys and values. So when you're adding a value a key value pair to a map, a data structure map, you're able to pass in a key and a value. So I'm able to do that here with every single one of these. Some of these I definitely want to set every time, like these right here. Some of these I don't want to set every time, like potentially any of these right here. So basically I'm creating a data structure weapon map. Once I've got all my values set, again, these are things like X and Y position, sounds that I want to make whenever an impact occurs, a type of impact. Sometimes I have a bullet impact. Sometimes I have a blood spatter. And then every once in a while I'll have a case where I'm trying to make the top half of the enemy do one thing and the bottom half of the enemy do another thing. So once I have that data structure weapon map created, I pass it back to this variable, and then I pass that variable through the weapon collision. And the weapon collision here, I have I've gotten creative and been able to figure out how to pass parameters into a script and overload the parameters if I want to. So what I mean by that is I have a default value set, and if I'm actually passing a value in that I want to overwrite that default value with, then I can do that. So here are some of those instances where the data structure weapon map that I created in the previous script, now I'm looking for those values, and if I have those values, then I set them, and then I do various things with them in this script down below. So this is where really the entire collision occurs, right? So here's my entire collision, and this handles every single collision with the mini blast bullet with every single enemy in the game so far. This is really good because I've really, really focused on reducing duplicate lines of code where possible, and I think I have it whittled down pretty good at this point. The other way that I had it was quite a bit redundant, but it had a lot of duplicate code, and that gets really hard to maintain as you move forward, mainly because when you are maintaining a project moving forward, you basically end up just having a hard time because you'll make a change in one place, but you forgot to change it in the four or five other places. So having reduced duplicate lines where possible, now you'll only have to change it in, you know, hopefully one place, very rarely a couple of places. So, so once we get through with the weapon collision and we do exactly what it is that we want to do with our impact, then we do a DS map destroy. And then the map, again, the data structure weapon map is only created when there's actually a collision that occurs. Once we've done what we want with that data structure weapon map inside of the collision, then we destroy it so that we're not taking up memory. We're basically doing some garbage collection. Very handy for us to keep the game flowing as smoothly as possible. So I just wanted to talk that through, and we demoed it, and now I got a chance to show you kind of what that looks like. Some things that me and the guys have been talking about, there's myself and Chris and Phil, and you know, we're basically the team of three indie devs working on Skycurser, and we've just been you know, doing some research, watching some games, watching some talks, getting some ideas. And one of the things that is really important to us is focusing on how the gameplay feels and just kind of the experience that the player is having as they're playing the game. So we definitely want there to be sort of a story to it, but also we want it to feel really good and satisfying as the player is getting visual feedback and inputting, you know, data into the game through the controls. We want it to feel really good to the player. So here we go. Let's I would like to modify a little bit of how we are doing some of the controls, and so I'm going to work through that on this stream. And let me just change a setting really quick. Okay, cool. I think I got the setting where I want it. So what's the first thing I want to work on? I think the first thing I want to work on is when there is a collision that occurs, I want to have a very, very, very slight pause on the game, enough to let the player feel like there was something that occurred that helped them feel better. And, you know, just that visual impact and feedback. And we're going to do this in two different ways. One is going to be with the Vulcan cannon. It's going to be a little slow. And it's going to be almost not noticeable to the player. And then one that we're going to do is more dramatic when we use the katana blade and pass it through the collision system. And I think we'll be in a good place there. So we've got Chris in chat right now. Hey, Chris, how's it going, man? Chris is working on one of the animations for level 2 for one of the enemies. So, and this enemy is really cool. It's a roach animation. And man, it looks really good from what I've seen, the artwork on it. So I'm really excited to get that into level 2. But I would like to get through these as quick as possible. So I'm going to modify a very few small number of things here and try to keep this moving so that I can, I'm trying to think what I want to do next. I think the very next thing I want to do is a toss up in my mind between level 2 enemy, and specifically the helicopter. And the other thing that I'm thinking about working on is pulling in the katana blade and the shotgun bullets into the weapon collision script. Now that we've got the work done on that script, we have very little tweaking to do to it. So I would almost like to get everything flowing through that script. And if we could do that, that would be a major win for the entire game. So first things first, though, let's make these small modifications to Skycurser and the controls with Skycurser. So I think first of all, we're going to go straight to the object Skycurser. Look in the step event. I need to pull a lot of these out of the step event and move them to scripts, but I haven't gotten a chance to do that yet. That's more code cleanup than anything. I don't want to focus on that right now. So I think what I'll do here is just focus on a couple of the small wins that we can have with the gameplay and the feel of the gameplay. So I'm looking here at this is the code that does the Vulcan cannon. And we have a button that we've set globally called key fire. We check to see if it's pressed. We check to make sure the shotgun button is not pressed, and a couple of other variables we also check to make sure are not occurring right at that instant. If they are occurring, we don't let the Vulcan cannon fire. But if they are not occurring and the player is holding down the keyboard button, or the arcade button, global key fire, then we let this occur. So we have an alarm here that actually does the firing. So I think we need to go to alarm 0 to look at the firing here, because that's going to be where the instance of the mini blast bullet is created. And we've got a lot of crazy animations in here. This mainly has to do with what Skycurser is doing, what his current position is, and what the gun that he has is doing as well. Let's see. Fire primary weapon, display its effects. So there's an instance create here. There's a key down, and there's a mini blast bullet here. These could better be done by passing through scripts, but I think what I would like to do, let me see here. I'm gonna try very, very slight movements. Bullet dot direction equals, let's actually randomly select the direction. Well, no, there will be a definite direction. Let me just think for a second how I want to do this. Direction selected equals, bullet counter equals 1. Go here, else do this. Okay, so this is every other. And there must be an incrementer for the bullet counter, which there is, plus here. So this is how it's controlled. So we can set var direction selected equals 0 for now. And then we can say else if bullet counter is equal to 1, go here. And this would all be better if we were passing it into a script again, but we will determine that here in a minute if we want to pass it into a script right now, because this is really going to be a major overhaul. So if you're tuning in and you're thinking best practices, I am too. I created a lot of this when I didn't understand the best practices of GameMaker and really what the best way to design GameMaker was. Really, we're talking about the technical design of GameMaker. And now that I understand a lot of it, this is going to be a major overhaul to get it right, and I don't want to spend a lot of valuable time on stream doing that. I'll talk through it once I've done it, but just figuring that out will take a little bit of time. So I think I'll just keep this moving forward for now. Instance create x plus 41, y plus 5, object mini blast bullet, and then we say bullet counter plus plus. And what I would like to do here is say bullet dot direction equals, this will be the first bullet dot direction down here, because this will be when it's zero. First one will be zero. Second one will go up slightly, like 3 degrees. Let's try 3 first. And the next one will be, the last one will be down at the bottom. And this will be 360 minus 3. So 357. And we're talking about degrees here, so that's what that represents. And I pretty much want to do the same with everything else. So let's do that really quick. Change this to 2, change this to 2. Add in the else if in between each one of these. And add in the direction with each one of these. 357. Is that what I put up here? Yep. And do the same thing down here. The direction of 3. Nope, 0, sorry. And change this to 5 and 9. See, 0, 1, 2. So really this could be 5 and this could be back to 9. Now that we've added another one in here. Nine direction could be 57. Whoops. And this would be 0. Two one zero. Direction. Should be good there. I'm gonna remove this direction selected. And remove this guy right here because the direction should be selected by this point, because we've got it set on every single case that could come through here. Okay, so the point of this is hopefully to make it a little bit more sporadic when firing, and that's pretty much intentional. So just thinking for a minute here, guys. 0, 1. Let's just see what this looks like. See if we even like it. It may feel really out of the ordinary, so we're just going to see how this feels. Just looking at some settings, guys. I'm waiting for the compile window to finish here. Looks like we're going in game.
Skycurser. Mission 1. Death at dusk. Go!
I actually really like the feel of this. Okay, so I really, really like the feel of that actually. And I like the angle. I don't think it's too dramatic. I didn't want it to be too dramatic. Basically, I'm sitting at the back of the screen, shooting all the way across the screen, and I liked basically where it ended up on the other side of the screen. So, okay, I like that. That's one small change I wanted to make. Another change I wanted to make, let's do that right now, which is going to be in the script for the weapon collision for the mini blast bullet. Right here. Actually, let's do it up one, which should be right here. If there is a collision, then do these things. But what does Game Maker have that allows me to sleep? So I guess sleep is an obsolete. Sleep a certain number of milliseconds. Obsolete function. Heard about someone doing this and really liked it. Liked the idea. Okay, and then the so Chris, what you're saying is gradually open up. The longer they hold it down, the more sporadic it gets up to a certain point. So that's fine for now, but yeah, okay. But there, it looks like there's no way to do sleep here with at least their current setup. I know I could come up with a way to do it, but let me just see here. Sleeping. Read only variable returns whether or not the current, not the instance is currently sleeping. Sleeping instance is one that's not actively engaged in any physical simulation. Put objects to sleep to save simulation cycles when an instance is at rest and not in collision with another instance. Nope. Not what I need. Want to know what the sleep. I think the sleep instance just kind of paused the game for a minute. So Game Maker Studio Sleep. Pretty pointless, but here's a Gmail replacement. Time equals current time, MS equals argument, zero. Do blank until current time minus time greater than or equal to round the number of milliseconds, return the current time minus time. That should do it. Simply put, it'll perform a loop until the specified time has passed. In turn, because GM does not use multi-threading, the entire game will halt and wait for the loop to stop. The elapsed time returned will be greater than the defined time, since it'll take GM a bit of extra time to finish running the code in the script. Even though it's possible, I highly do not recommend using sleep. But I think that's the point of sleep. People are saying it was a bad way to do it, but I think that's the point of it. I mean, I think this is a perfectly good solution for what we're talking about. Okay, so it looks like there's one of two ways I can do it based on what I'm reading. I can A, pass everything through a parent and give it a property, give everything the same property, which is sleep true or false, and then set it to true, set the property to true. And let me see if what Chris has here. So I'm reading this guy. Well, I think the main thing is this one will actually work from what I can tell. So I'm actually just gonna add, I'm just gonna try to add this in here to our Game Maker instance. I like it. I think it's a simple solution. Yeah. So let's just try this. Should be a helper. Script, create script. Script, sleep. Pass this in. Let's format this the way we would format this. I like the use of commas to create the different variables. And this is fine as well. So I think we just say sleep script. Argument 0, equals delay in milliseconds. Okay, script sleep, play, and we do this in milliseconds, so let's just say 0.2 seconds for now to see what that feels like, and then hit play and see what it looks like.
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
Okay, let's make it way smaller than that. I liked it. Let's do the 20, like the recommendation was that I saw. That does work. It's going to be about a tenth of that pause that we just saw. Which I think should feel like almost perfect.
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
Okay, so I think that's good. I mean, there's not much of a, there's, when you're looking at it, it's a little bit, you're kind of like, is that intentional or unintentional? I think it feels just right to me. Like, I wouldn't want it to be, longer pauses for bigger enemies, maybe no pause for smaller ones. Okay, then we would have to determine, we would probably set that in each enemy what the pause in milliseconds should be, impact effect, right? So let's set a default right now and then just modify the default. Let's do that right now. Base enemy in the create event. We got to go to the script object base enemy init. This will be sleep equals 20. So everything will be default 20. I won't even have to specify it with everything. And then in that script that does the connection, the weapon collision, I think it's this guy right here, we just then say argument one dot, actually instead of argument one, let's just say hit dot sleep. That should take care of it. Point and click game, finally decided. Sweet man, so you're gonna use JavaScript and HTML5 to do that? Like you were talking about the other day. Tell me about it. Be a better indie dev every day. Tell me about what you came up with. So hit dot sleep. So yeah, point and click would be really good, especially for phones too. I mean, there's basically like, I don't know what the gesture is on smartphones, but I'm thinking it would be something like tap or click on the phone. So it could go a long way. All right, next we are going to update the enemies to each have their own sleep. So let's, I don't want to tweak this too much, guys. I think tweaking it too much could have a negative effect. So let's keep the numbers small. Sleep 30 there. I don't know. I think this guy might be like, I think maybe this would be better to be 30, and the enemy number one would be better to be 40. So let's do that. AGS. I'm not sure what that is. What is AGS? This guy will be 40. He's a little bit bigger than the other two. Three will basically be our default. It's the smallest one, so it'll have that 20. This guy will be a little bit larger, so he'll either be 40 or 45. I think 45 would probably be good. And 45 there. This guy is going to be real small. Actually, he's going to be default. Tank is going to have, this is actually the carrier. So this guy will be much larger. This guy, let's put up to 70 milliseconds. Still not that much overall, but enough to hopefully let the player feel it. Adventure Game Studio, got it. Point and click, more fun for you. What I'm not going to do is like finding artists and musicians, because I'm going for a very specific market slash style. What I'm not going to like is finding artists and musicians. Because what you're saying is you're going to have to find some sound engineers and some artists to do the artwork for you while you program it, right? So this guy's the boss, much larger. I still don't want to do crazy on this guy, so I'm just going to put 90 here, and let's just call that like our range and see how that feels. Now, I haven't really even touched the enemies on level 2, but that's not a big deal because right now we've only really got one enemy, and we can just add him real quick. He's already got a sleep of 20. Let's set this guy to 50. Style is obsolete, basically. Yeah. Okay, got that done, guys. Going in game to see what this feels and looks like. Let's see what this is here. They think I'm using the obsolete sleep function, which I'm not. Let's just call this sleeper and update it everywhere that we wrote it. Funny that they think I'm doing that. But I'm not, game maker. Come on. Game maker's slow to respond. Guess what? My computer's going slow. This guy's enemy 2. Where is he? This guy shouldn't be down here. Okay, sounds good, Chris. Talk to you soon, man. Zero worries. Come on, come on, game maker. Stop acting crazy on me here. I'm just trying to get some stuff done. Okay. Enemy one. Enemy one. Heli wolf. This guy's not inheriting anyway, which would be a problem. So let's make him inherit. And let's make sure he's connected to the parent. Yeah, he is, but he just wasn't inheriting. Let me verify that. Yeah. So now he's inheriting from the parent. And we should have fixed all of our bugs, or our quote unquote bugs. So I think, guys, here in a minute, I'm just going to have to go get a fan and point it at my computer like I've been doing the last couple nights, only because my computer's running so slow and hot. So usually when I'm streaming, if I don't have a fan blowing on it, it just gets overheated.
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
Tank eyeball. So let me make sure that enemy gets updated. Tank eyeball, this guy right here. So this guy is not actually inheriting from the parent, and I think he is a child. Yes, he is. He should be inheriting. The other thing that I figured though was when that was occurring, guys, like Chris's idea was to slow it down depending on which enemy is getting hit, so a larger enemy would get a bigger slowdown, but it just feels like lag when we slow it down as much as we were doing. So I think I'm gonna keep it to that 20 and maybe increase it by slight to like 30, but everything else will get it removed here, because it just, I think it feels like the game is lagging rather than the game has a really cool visual effect that's occurring. So this guy, yep, has the same sleeper. This guy has the same sleeper. This guy has a different one. Sleeper, thumbs up. Hit okay. Man, that is old school CTXCB. Is that gonna be your style? I mean, I think if you do it right, you can get a base of people who like it and want to play it. I think you have to be proactive about your marketing. but I think it's possible though. I mean, I don't know how big the audience is for an art style like that, but if it's point and click, I mean, maybe it's more about the game experience than the art experience as well. You know, I mean, I think, yeah, the art definitely should be there and has to be there. Classic Sierra Adventure Games. Cool, man. But yeah, I don't. I think you could pull it off. Okay. We're gonna pause for a timeout for a minute, guys, while I go get a fan so we can keep this show going. It's just gonna take me a minute to get the fan set up. Probably less than 3 minutes total. So. Give me just a second. Now's a good time to grab a drink if you're watching, and I'll be right back. Okay, we're back. Thanks for being patient, guys. All right. Let's, can you guys still hear me just fine, or how are we doing on sound? Okay, so got that set up. I think the last thing I wanted to do was go ahead and change this to 30 instead of 20. And I'm gonna do one more small piece here. It's gonna feel pretty good, I think. Change this to 30. Good, sound is fine, good. All right. Okay, and then the next piece here. Yeah, I like that CTXCB. I like the idea of showing people that story and game experience are important. I don't mind you saying more important than art, because I'm a developer, but a lot of art guys might give you a hard time about that one. But not to worry. All right, so So the last thing I wanted to do was actually, when you're firing, I did want to implement screen shake. And I'm trying to think of the best way to do this. Yeah, I agree. It is important on that. One of my favorite games, I'm trying to remember what the name of it was. It was on Nintendo, and it was simply like a, I'm drawing a blank on it. But it was just kind of like a puzzle game, and you would move from screen to screen, and there would be almost zero animation. You could pick things up on each screen and then take them to the next part, but you would basically have to solve riddles all the way throughout. It was almost like an escape game. You know how some of the games these days, you just kind of have to escape from a certain place. It was kind of like that, but it was more story driven and had some really cool elements to it. So I really liked it because you had to think about what you had to do with the objects that you had, how you had to use them. So, all right. Now, how do we get everything to shake the way that we want it to shake? Because right now we have a shake. Let's go observe this shake. I kind of want the shake to occur like almost all the time though. So we'll watch this here in a second. I'll show it to you. So the shake occurs very specifically whenever you destroy the tank. The tank is the carrier in this case.
Mission 1. Death at dusk. Go!
Destroy this thing. So you kind of see how we did that screen shake. The top of the screen shakes, and the basically the viewport shakes whenever the carrier dies. So I'd kind of like everything to shake a little bit more though than it does right now. I'm just trying to think of how I would do that. And let's go look at that shake on the tank. That would be on the death animation. Tank 1 die, I'm sure it's there. Let's go look at that script. Script screen shake, and so I guess I've got it right here. -5, -5, and 60. Let's go look at that script. It's got to be a helper script. I wrote this a while back. It's been a while. So I guess I have an object, and yep, he's fine. So shake length is here, object screen shake is there. Let's go look at that guy. That's probably, yeah, Here it is, under controllers. View high, view low, shake length. View high, view low, shake length. Step is zero, alarm activated is false. Step plus plus, if step is less than or equal to 5 and alarm is activated, alarm activated is false, then set the shake length and alarm activated equals true. View X view, view Y view, and then your lows and highs. Argument 0, argument 1, and I put it to negative 5, positive 5, and the shake length was 60, so that happens for an entire second. So we then, after it's called, I pass in shake length. In this case, I don't think it's happening for a second. Oh yeah, it is happening for a second. So I think I stopped the shake. I think I stopped the, yeah, so I reset it back to where it was, and then I destroy the instance and the alarm. Got it. So I'm making it shake the entire time in the step event, and then when it hits, let me see this here. Okay, so if in the first 5 steps the alarm hasn't been activated, then activate it. It gets set for 1 second, and it only gets set once. And then we shake, we begin shaking the screen right here, and then in the alarm we set the view X view and view Y view back to 0, and then do an instance destroy. I'm wondering how all this would play out if we passed if we passed basically every single object that's on screen through a script like this, if we could get that effect to occur. And I feel like we could. I'm just debating in my mind how we should do this. So it tries to do view X view, view Y view, and change the X and Y positions of those, but it doesn't really affect everything else. So let's go look at those. Guess technically I wouldn't be able to do it on everything, mainly because the backgrounds are the exact size of the screen. Sorry guys, give me a second while I read this. I think this actually might be a little bit easier than I think, and it might still work fairly decently. This might work fairly decently still, so give me a second here. I think I could try this just with the view, X view, and Y view, it happening there. Let's see how we called this again. So close this guy. Don't need that. Just grab this. See how this feels when we do it with other objects. And again, let's put everything through here. And I don't necessarily think I want to do it on collision, but I wouldn't mind doing it on destroy. But I do want to give a default, and I need to do this in the init script. So length is the amount of time in steps, because that's how alarms work. Once I set it, the alarm gets decremented once every step. So since I have 60 steps in the room, this would be about a third of a second right here. So let's just try this by default, see what this feels like. X change, Y change. Shake length, and on destroy we'll say okay, so we got this set up, guys. Going in game.
Mission 1. Death at dusk. Go!
That just looks a little glitchy more than me. Kind of surprised it ended up being so bad. I know what the problem was. I don't think it's the X change and Y change, it's the positive and negative values. And I set them both to 3. I don't know why I did that. I keep thinking it's going to be in the action. So this is the pause val, negative val, shake, negative val, shake, positive val. Copy this guy, the negative val, have a negative. So it was just looking more like a glitch than anything, but I think this should fix it. Okay, let's try this.
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
Okay, so one other thing we'll do is decrease that value, because I think really just two in either direction would probably be fine. And the length of time, I just can't make my mind up on. I feel like that length is probably fine for now. So the only thing I need to do here is make sure that we remove this script that is basically occurring right now from the tank, because it's going to occur no matter what. Or let's just comment it out for now and override these values in the init script for the tank. Just set them to what they were. This would be 5, 5, 60. Then hit play. And maybe the only time that we have this occur is actually more when there's an actual explosion and not when there's a meat explosion. Not when anything dies.
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
And honestly, I think because of this, I can slow down. I can make the sleep a little bit faster, because there's a lot of good visual feedback right there. Chris, do you want everything to shake? Because if you do, I could do that. It's just going to take a little bit of work. Right now, I'm just setting it up so that we just have a little bit more feedback when anything is happening. Honestly, I wouldn't mind setting that up right now. Okay. I won't set the pebs and febs to sleep. Where am I? Object, enemy, base, init. Gotta collect myself, man. Jeez, I'm losing it here. 20. And remove the sleep from enemy 3 and the bubble eyeballs. So we basically just say here, sleeper equals 0. So good there. Enemy 5, same thing. Sleeper equals 0. Good, good, good. Be amazing to see other things shaking. I've wanted to see that for a while. Okay, let's just check this out really quick. Are you saying also that the bubble eyeballs and the febs, so the febs don't need to sleep? You don't want the floating eyeballs to sleep? Are you saying also that the pebs and febs, you don't want the screen to shake either, or what?
Mission 1, Death at Dusk. Go!
So, one other thing we'll do to control this, Chris is saying, no screen shake for meat and no sleep except for larger enemies. So, I think we'll set two properties then, Chris, on every object. One property will be type, and I guess we'll say type is just meat or metal, and the other one will be size. Yeah, we'll get the longer sleep for deflect, and I can't do that yet because I don't have the katana going through the weapon collision script yet. Yeah, I don't have the katana going through the weapon collision yet. So as soon as that goes through, I'll program that in. Otherwise, it's just going to be pointless for me to program it in where it's at currently. Okay. So script objects enemy init. So anything small or meat, first of all, small gets no sleep, and anything meat gets no screen shake. So let me just put the purpose of this. Enum meat or metal, no screen shake on meat. Enum, small, medium, large. I don't know. I don't have anything for medium, really. Anything medium or anything not small. Small, let's say no sleep on small. If you're not familiar with what enum is, it basically just means an enumeration, and meaning it can only be one of the following values. So it can only be small or medium or large, because those are the only values that I'm going to handle. If I was like very particular about this, I would make sure that there was an error if it wasn't small, medium, or large, but I think it's fine the way it is right now. And I just handle what happens if it's a small, medium, or large. Same with meter metal. I just handle what happens if it's meter metal and don't worry about anything else that's passed in, because that's all I'm going to look for. So E type, E size, E stands for enemy. Okay, on the destroy, first of all, we say if E type is equal to metal, then you can do a screen shake. Nothing is set to metal by default, so there will be no screen shake by default. Additionally, on the hit that we've got going right now, let's go modify the hit piece. If hit dot e size is equal to small, and we'll modify that slightly to say not equal to small. Actually, I'll look for medium or large. And I said that incorrectly right there. Medium or large, hit size, hit dot e size is equal to medium, or hit dot e size is equal to large, then do the sleeper. Okay, we're good there. Now the last thing that we have to do is on the ones that we do want to sleep, or the ones that we do want to explode, we got to set those properties. So for sure on enemy one, we got to set that. And so we're under objects, enemy one, we got to set that property that type is metal. And on the tank, same, metal. And let's see, boss is not metal. Enemy 2, 3, 4. Yep, we're good there. Heli is metal. Let's add that in there. Metal. Okay. And then the last thing we need to do is determine what size each of these are. And really, we only need to set the size of anything larger than small. So this guy, I'm going to say, is medium. Definitely medium. Good. This guy is, I'm going to leave that guy at small because I think Chris thinks it's small. 4, we'll go ahead and set this guy to sleep a little bit. He's a pretty large guy. Did I set the last guy to small? I didn't mean to set him to small. Let's set him to medium. Yeah, I did. Set them to medium instead. Okay, good there. Enemy 5, that guy. Tank, yes, definitely large. Large. Get out of here. Tank, good. Boss is definitely large, and Heli is definitely medium. I'm not gonna do, actually on boss, I don't think I want to do a sleep on boss, so I'll take that away. Well, back to our conversation, the sleep is so small, I think having it on there is going to be fine. Like on the boss, it's not going to feel like lag. It's going to feel correct. Boss 1, and then heli. Medium. Boom. Done. Okay, now all that will work just fine. So then the last thing that we want to do is get everything to shake. Chris, my concern about everything shaking right now is mainly with the background. The background, I could pass every enemy and every obstacle through this, the shake engine, but right now the background is built exactly for the size of the screen. So if I shake it at all, it will basically expose what's behind the background, which is nothing. So I think logically I should only pass like floating objects through the shake engine. So let's try that, and I'm not sure even how this will work if an object has a speed on it and it's going a certain direction. So let's just test it out. We've got a speed engine, a depth engine, and I would like to create a shake engine. Where should I put this? So I think what we need on destroy is to pass everything through the script shake engine, specifically this object's X and Y position and the object itself. No, I take that back. Let's do this first. Take that out. It makes no sense to pass an object that's dying through the shake engine. We need everything to shake. So I think this actually might be way easier than I think it is. Instance, activate. All maybe that's not what it is. Deactivate all would count create. Okay, so never mind on that. It will be a little bit more work, but that's fine. Okay. Chris, all I was saying was that I don't think I can make everything pass through, or I don't think I can make literally everything shake, especially the background, because if the background shakes, it's going to expose some of the sides, the top and the back, you know, what's behind the background, because the background is built exactly for the size that it is. So if we make the background shake, then we expose what's behind the background, which is nothing. If the background was built so that it was just a little bit bigger than the screen, then maybe it could work. But even then, we're going to run into some difficulties. We could make it black. Yeah, I mean, I could do it.
Let's do it.
Let's go try to control that real quick. Backgrounds are black. And if something shakes, well, let's just try it. Let's pass everything through. If not, we just take the objects, the background objects out of the equation, and just don't do it to the background objects. So everything else though. Should shake on anything that dies. So this should be fairly simple, actually. I should just be able to create a script for this. So on enemy death, go ahead and call the shake engine. And let's try this. Let's just try it with one object first. So I'm just thinking real quick, give me a minute. Cool, man. Sounds good. Take it easy. I'll text you if I get a chance. See ya. So the screen shake then calls the object controller, eventually calls the object controller. And here's the object controller. And in the step event, I would like to then pass everything through the script shake engine. But this is where we can call this, where we'll make the viewport shake. But we should also be able to make the shake, all the objects shake here as well. So from the shake engine, then get out of here. We don't really need this guy anymore. Here we go. Now, let's just try this with one or two objects first. If instance exists, object enemy one. Then man, I'm not sure how to grab all the instances of one object. I think I could say try this with object enemy one. Original position X equals object enemy one X. Var op y equals object enemy one dot y. OPX, OPY, and I don't need to put object enemy one here and here because it's in the width statement. If initial position is equal to true. And then it is else. Ooh, let me think about this for a second. Say if initial position is equal to true, OPX equals X, OPY equals Y, and say X equals OPX. Let's grab a couple things out of this. Screen shake here, create event, initial POS equals true. Self, pass self in, but also pass in view low, view high end. And we will pass those right into here. So script shake engine view argument 0 equals object screen shake. So we have the properties available to us from there. Argument 1 equals view low. Argument 2 equals view high. OPX random range. OPX plus argument. Make these much smaller, so we can say var arg1 equals 0 equals here, and if argument count greater than 0, then var arg0 equals argument 0. If argument count greater than 1, on and then do the same thing for argument 2. And then set defaults, bar arg0 equals false, var arg1 equals 0, var arg2 equals 0, and then we just down here say if arg0. So if it's anything else besides false, then this will run, which it will be because it will be an object. So if instance exists, object enemy 1, do that. And then we go here plus arg1, and then op x plus arg2. And maybe I have everything do the exact same specific movement. So let's just do that outside of here. Var final x, var final y. That might be, won't be able to do it that way. So we just take out the opex here. And then just add that. Arg1, arg2. And then just say opex plus final x. And we may do something similar here to what we did previously, which is simply, let me think for a second, creating a list of objects in that could be in each room. And then just looping through each of those objects and passing those objects off to a script that will do this dirty work so that we don't have to worry about creating tons of variables. But I guess we could just check this first and see if this works. And the maximum it'll do mainly for 20 steps, which is a third of a second. Unless it's a big one, then it'll be 60 steps, which will be 1 second. Let's try this first and see if this works with only the PEBs. I meant to apply this to object 3 because object 3 will be a better indicator. Because object 1 is the EBP, the eyeball plane, and there's only a few of those really in the game, especially in the first part of the game. So let's go back up here. Shake engine changes to 3. Save, and as soon as this compiles, we'll get out and recompile. So done, recompile, and show us what you got. Yeah, so if this works, we can just pass everything through this script and everything will work. If it doesn't, we gotta back to the drawing board.
Mission 1, death at dusk, go!
Okay, so that might be a bad test, mainly because that is on a path. I'm thinking about this, and paths behave quite a bit differently times the x-coordinate of a given path's given defining point. Point identity to check. Get point. Path get X. Here we go. I can get the X and the Y, but can I set the X and the Y? Okay. This will set the why does a get do setting? This is a little bit confusing, game maker. With this function, you can get the x coordinate of a position on any given path. 0 is the start of the path, 1 is the end of the path, and anything in between equates to that far through the path. This needn't be a defining point of the path, it could be anywhere on it. Got it. So 0 through 1, you get an x position. This will set the calling instances x to the x coordinate of the point at exactly halfway through the path. Ah, I see. That makes sense. You're not doing any setting with the path itself, but you're just setting a variable to the path. So faith has been restored, game maker, no worries. Insert mirror orientation, that's path index. The index of the path of calling instance is following. Position? Scale, reverse, rotate, scale, set closed, set kind, path set precision, path shift. Ah, look at this. This could work. Yeah. Path shift. This could be really good. Huh. This would be crazy. Number of horizontal pixels to shift the path. Negative equals left, positive equals right, as it should. Negative equals up, positive equals down, as it should. So we'll just say with enemy 3, path shift, and then let's look at this. Yeah, let's do it like that. Alright, so this is a little crazy, so gotta write this quick while I'm still thinking about it. Scripts. We're in the helpers, and we are doing the shake engine. And we are here, and we want to say with object enemy 3 with path popcorn, path shift, not popcorn, change this to X selected. It's not technically the final Y position or final X position, Y selected. And this would be here we can say then var final X equals 0, var final Y equals 0, and then then we can say X selected plus or Y selected, and then change these to OPX plus and OPY plus, and move these down here, remove this guy, actually keep that guy. Game Maker, please get your freaking tabs worked out, because this is out of control. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. OPX plus X select, Y select. Selected X and selected Y. At the very end of the script, initial position should equal false. And I gotta think about this for a second. I think I gotta pass initial position into the argument.